Good afternoon, 100% here. I am Renjith Mathuroy, International MSc Physics student here at University of Stuttgart. Today, I'll try to give you a brief understanding about one of the current hot topics in condensed matter physics, that is the topological insulators. So, the content of my talk includes an introduction where I'll just give a brief idea of what is topology and about the Nobel Prize in physics and so on. So, under the topological band theory of solids, I will explain why the quantum Hall state is quantized, and then some three theories to understand the further things, that is the chiral edge state, time reversal symmetry, and Cramer's theorem. Then in the third part, I'll explain the quantum spill Hall system, and then why there is no scattering and so on. So in the fourth part, I'll go directly into the 2D topological insulators, their theoretical predictions, and the experimental discovery. Similarly, in the fifth part, I'll go with 3D insulator theory and the experimental discovery. And finally, I'll conclude with the applications. So before we start, we need to understand what is the main principle to understand a matter. So the condensed matter physics actually deals with the study of how the atoms are arranged, or how the electron moves around in, and how different phases of matter are formed, and so on. This arrangement can create a lot of beautiful phases of matter, like the normal crystal solids and some exotic materials like our superconductors and our topological insulators. So, symmetry is one of the things to understand the matter. So symmetrical operations should leave the system invariant, and different symmetry groups will create different phases of matter, and a phase change can happen when spontaneous symmetry breaking happens. So there are different types of symmetry, right? We have the rotational symmetry, translational symmetry, time reversal symmetry, and so on. So now, what is topology? Topology is nothing but actually a branch of mathematics which study the property of an object under adiabatic deformations. So according to topology, a donut and a cup belongs to same category, but a donut and a pretzel belongs to different category. And why is it so? The answer is very simple. A donut and a cup have same single chord, while the other has different. So this is a simple idea. Here in topology, we can only have integral holds. And this simple understanding came up to be very good things to describe the electronic phases of matter. And the quantum Hall state came the first example of topologically distinct matter from other types of phases. The Nobel Prize in Physics for 2016 was actually awarded to Professor Tholos, Halde, and Kosters for their theoretical discoveries of topological phases, phase transitions, and topological phases of matter. They use this topology as a tool to explain the phenomena of unusual exotic material phases. You know, matter behaves dramatically in higher temperature and low temperature, especially in the low temperature. And they can create exotic matters like superconductivity and superfluid. In superfluid, just the spin vortex formation happens, and they can just spin forever. So in high lower temperature, the spin vortex form as pair, and then in high temperature they get separated, and this transition is called constant Tholos transition. But we are not going to go into this because this is just regarding the Nobel Prize. Then in 1982, Professor Halde actually studied the topological aspects of atomic magnets. Now for our understanding for this presentation, we have to focus on Professor Tholos. He in 1983 actually gave a good explanation for why the Hall conductance is quantized, and he connected it with topology, and half of the price was actually for that particular thing. Now, why we need a topological insulator? The first and important thing is that we want to do more with our phone. Yes, we know there are high loss when the electricity passes through a conductor, the Joule CT, and the Moore's law states that the transistor won't be doing much good in the future, and we need some solution. And one solution is indeed the superconductors, but as we know, it requires a low temperature. Even though the high temperature superconductors are on its way, it's quite challenging. So we need some different new material. So to understand that, let me introduce you to this topological band theory of solid. So to refresh your understanding, so you know the insulators and semiconductors and the conductors are just having different valence and conduction band, band gaps. So insulators have a big band gap, while the conductors have no band gap. So this band gap differentiates them. So when the atoms come close together, they can form orbital overlapping and they form bands. And this is how the band structure formation happens. And this is a simple band structure of silicon. Now, we say that this is an atomic insulator and this is a covalent insulator, a semiconductor. So we know that both of them are actually having a band gap. While the atomic insulator have a wide band gap, the other semiconductor has a small band gap. But anyway, both of them have band gap. So according to topology, we can slowly change their band gap, but it should not close. And another idea is that these old conventional insulators are actually indeed equivalent to vacuum, and they all belongs to the same phase. This is what topology says. So from now on, we only focus on the insulator. So this means that I can slowly deform the band gap without removing the insulating property, right? Now the question is, are all the electronic states with an energy gap topologically equivalent to that of vacuum? And the answer is actually no. And the further examples will be leading to the fascinating matter that we need. As I told, the orange and a bowl belongs to the same topological class. They belong to the same phase, and I'll define that by this diagram here. And I say that this is actually an insulating state, and I call that Ganus is equal to zero. And here, in the second phase, this donut and the coffee cup belong to the same phase, and I say that this Ganus is equal to one. But what is that state? I don't know. So my question is there any electronic states of matter, electronic state that belongs to this category? And that is what I need to find. So as Nico Heuser explained in the quantum Hall effect, explain the quantum Hall effect in detail in today morning, I'll just briefly refresh it. So basically, the 2D electron gas are confined in a matter like this, and it is cooled below in very low temperature, and a strong magnetic field, most important, strong magnetic field is applied. So Lorentz force creates the circular orbits, and they move with the cyclotron frequency, leading to the quantized lambda levels. And the quantized levels are given by the energy is given by Ns equal to plus half h cross omega c. And the basic idea that I want to focus here is the quantum Hall state are actually quantized, well quantized. It is e square by h into n. That is, they are in integral multiples of e square by n. That is, keep that in mind. Next question is why it is quantized. We need to understand why this quantization is there. So, in 1982, Professor Tholos actually derived a formula that connects the quantized Hall conductance to something called a Chern number. That means he connected this with topology. Let's see how did he do it. So, this is the degeneracy of a Landau level, H by E. Now, he defined a wave function U of kn, that's a block wave function, for the nth Landau level with crystal momentum k in the first Willow zone. So, for an electron in the whole lattice, we need to consider the Hall conductivity over the whole Willow zone, that is a closed surface. Now, the basically, here, the valence band electron can actually vary very smoothly as a function of momentum k in the presence of a band gap, energy gap. And this can be classified as integer topological invariant. So, he found a topological invariant n, which is defined as this one. It is called TKNN topological invariant, where T stands for Tholos, Consolus, the people who were in that paper. So, this is the thing. And this is also called the Chern number. And this is a function of our vector potential. This thing here in the brackets are defined as is the vector potential or the very phase in the momentum space, momentum phase, and the corresponding field strength is given by this. So, the basic idea here is that this can be analogous to something called winding number. Let's say a system which takes one turn around a point, then we call the winding number to be is equal to 1. If it takes two turns, then winding number is equal to 2, and so on. So, here this n is actually the n which I told you to keep it in mind, the integer quantum, that integer, that is this. So, he connected the quantization of the Hall effect into this topological invariant n. This is the connection. And this n actually tells about the edge mode that carry the current. We'll learn about soon. So, let's see what the edge state is. In the normal presence of the magnetic field, the electron will take a circular turn, as I shown here. But you know what happens. So, what happens at the edge state? In the edge state, they actually bounces off like this. And classically, we can say this as the skipping orbit. In quantum mechanics, we call it one-dimensional Chiral-Dirac fermions. And the specialty is that this just moves in one direction. This is moving straight. And you can connect the bulk and the boundary. And there is a bulk boundary correspondence. You can see, as I told before, the n, the Chern number, is actually 0 for an insulator. That is the orange I was mentioning in the beginning. And the n is equal to 1 for the quantum Hall state. And the Chern number actually connects the bulk part, bulk invariant here, and also relates to the boundary invariant, which is given by the chiral edge mode. And this is the usual conduction and valence band. And you can see here, there is a small edge state here. And the valence and the conduction band has the energy gap, and they don't do anything, they are insulators. But this edge state is there, and that is special. And what are the properties of this chiral edge state? The electric current flow without dissipation, and they are precisely quantized, and they are insensitive to disorder. Now, let's look at this edge mode in detail. So, this is the classical picture, the skipping orbit, and this is the quantum picture where the chiral edge state is there. And specialty is this momentum and the spin are actually locked. It is the momentum spin locking is there. We will explain it later in plus few slides. So, here, you know, at low temperature also there are many random fluctuations. But since the counter propagating state is not there, there is no scattering. That is, this state is actually very robust. And this is how the usual connection looks like. You have the high voltage measured here. This is the conventional current flowing. The magnetic field is applied perpendicular to this one. This is how it looks like. You can see that state here. And you have to understand the time reversal symmetry. In the presence of magnetic field, actually the time reversal symmetry is breaking, and this has a dramatic consequence that I'll explain in few slides. So what is our aim? Our aim is actually to get a low dissipative current transmission. That is, there should be no heating at all. But as I told, a huge magnetic field is needed. But that is not possible. We can't carry the magnetic huge magnet in our with our phone, right? So it is quite difficult. So we need to get a magnet within the material. That is what we need. We need a magnetic field within the material. And this is how this picture depicts how a usual conductor looks like. And this is the chiral state that I was mentioning. And this is what we need. We need to allow the electron to flow in opposite direction. And let's see, will we get a magnetic field from it or not? So before continuing, let me explain what the time reversal symmetry is. So time reversal symmetry just means that the property of the system should be unchanged when the time is reversed. So if a Hamiltonian is there and time reversal operator is applied, and Hamiltonian will should be just the same, but a current is flowing like this in one direction. That is, so when we reverse the current flow, that is the time reversal operator is applied, what you can see here that the magnetic field direction is changed. So the magnetic field direction will change when time reversal thing happen. So basically the conclusion is that magnetic field actually can break the time reversal thing. Also, you can see the electron will be flowing in one direction, magnetic field will be in down direction. And if the electron flows in the other direction, spins in the other direction, magnetic field in the opposite direction. So spin also get flipped when the time is reversed, or the left mover become the right mover. Now, one more theory to understand is the Cramer's theorem. This just states that if we have a state this plus or minus, which is in the same energy state and is regulated by this time reversal operator, then this system should have two independent states. That just means that for a spin half particle which obeys the time reversal symmetry, then all the state has to be twofold degenerate. That means if one up spin is there, then other downspin has to be there in a same energy state. That's the basic idea. So if you apply the time reversal symmetry twice, then you have to get a minus one. That means the other state has to be different from the first one. So as I told, the integral quantum Hall state requires a broken symmetry, and we need a magnetic field inside. That means we don't need a broken symmetry. So is there any topological phases with this unbroken symmetry that we need to find? So I'll propose one Tolle model like this. That is, when electron flows in along the edge state, we know a magnetic field will be produced. Similarly, if the electron flows in the opposite direction, the magnetic field will be in other direction. So if I combine both, I'll get a state like this. And I call this topological, 2D topological insulator. This is what we need. Here, we have an inbuilt magnetic field. That means the external magnetic field is zero. So here, the quantum spin Hall system as a superposition of two quantum Hall systems. So I call, this is actually called the quantum spin Hall system. And this is a toy model with the Cramer's theorem. We get a pair of edge state like this, and you know here also the spin and momentum is locked. And how is this possible? How can this be done? How is it done? The answer is very simple. It is because of this spin orbit coupling. You know, spin electron has its own spin and it revolves around the nucleus, and that causes a magnetic moment for the orbit and for the spin. So we have a magnetic moment for spin and this nucleus here. So the interaction energy is actually related with the both of them. Angular momentum of the spin and angular momentum of the orbit. And also you can see one important fact, that the interaction energy here is actually related directly proportional to z, that is the atomic number. That means for heavier system will be having high spin orbit coupling. Heavier system means Mercury, Venus, and so on. So this is very important here. So just to summarize the quantum spin Hall state, as I told, here the quantum spin Hall state has the conduction band and valence band, and it is separated by a band gap, and the system is insulating. But we have edge state. We have two edge state here, with each one corresponding to opposite spin, like this. And this is nothing but similar to that of the one-dimensional quantum wire. The edge state is what is conducting, but the other thing, the conduction and valence band has energy gap, and that whole system is actually insulating. And this is actually also immune to impurities or other perturbations. And why there is no scattering or so on? The explanation is very simple here. This is the picture, you know, that's it, as I told before. Now, they are actually related, the Cramer, as you know, these two states here forms Cramer's doublet, and they are related by time reversal operator. So, absence of scattering means that the vector, the scattering potential, the matrix element of the scattering potential will become zero. So, if I apply, so consider a consider a potential V, and we apply the Cramer's theorem and time reversal operator, and you see that this matrix element becoming zero. That is, the V is equal to V dagger. That means the matrix element is equal to zero. That means there is no scattering at all. So you can see here, even though some irregularities in this potential region here comes into play, this trajectory of the motion of, sorry, the trajectory of our spin system edge state is just flowing like this. It is not at all scattered, or it stays the same. That means they stay as a time reverse partner. As Nitin Thomas Alex explained in the Anderson localization for the one dimensional conductor. But here, even though this conduction can be called as a one dimensional edge state, this does not have any Anderson localization. That won't happen in this topological insulator here. Now, I was explaining you about the Choi model, right? So now let's go into the actual discovery. This is just simple cartoon explaining what I told you, two-edge state like this here. Okay, so now I'm going to this 2D topological insulator. You know, so the quantum spin Hall state, the quantum spin Hall insulator is actually what is called the 2D topological insulator, that you have to keep in mind. Okay, so I was actually explaining to you about the 2D topological insulator. So in 2006, Bernwick, Huygens, and Fang gave a theoretical prediction that HG Mercury telluride could be a best candidate for the 2D topological insulator. This is just the theory. So what they did is, they told that if you make a quantum well out of mercury telluride and cadmium telluride, then this should be topologically insulated. So you can see this is the band structure of mercury telluride, and this is the band structure of cadmium telluride. And if I say the red line corresponds to the valence band, and the blue one corresponds to the conduction band, you can see a peculiarity in mercury telluride. That is, here the valence band is actually above the conduction band. That should not be the case, right? Here, this is the normal. Conduction band is above the valence band. Why this is so? Keep that in mind, okay? So, this is the quantum well. This is how the quantum well structure look like. So E1 is the conduction band and the H1 is the valence band. So this has a thickness D. They say that if the thickness D is less than something, a critical thickness, then this has a normal band structure. But when the thickness D becomes greater than the critical thickness DC, then this become topological insulators. That means the band inversion will be happening. So the main idea is that for a topological insulator to form, a band inversion has to take place. Now let me explain about the band inversion in detail. What is the reason for band inversion? Simple, as I told, it is nothing but the spin orbit coupling. So in heavier metals, the p orbital band actually is pushed above the s band, and band inversion will be happening. So this is how the band without spin orbit coupling look like, and this is how the bands with spin orbit coupling looks like. So this is energy of a band versus the quantum well thickness D. You can see here E1 is this conduction band, and the H1 here is the one, red one is the valence band. And in the normal case, for D is equal to 40 angstrom, you can see the valence conduction band is above the valence band. But when the thickness becomes 63.5 angstrom, it is becoming stopped. So the band is crossing actually, but still it is not above because it is less than DC. But for D greater than DC, you can see at around 70 angstrom, at the K point, the band inversion is happening. So this is how the band, a normal band in 3D and inverted band in 3D looks like. Now, okay, next question is, why did we use the cadmium telluride along with the mercury telluride? Because it has a similar lattice constant. Both of them have similar lattice constants, so you can easily compare them. Also, second thing is that cadmium telluride has a weaker spin orbit coupling. Now, in the normal case, the cadmium telluride dominates, that is, the normal band ordering should happen. But in the inverted case, that is, after spin orbit couplings come into play, the band inversion happens. So if you write a Hamiltonian describing this 2D topological insulator, we get the solution which gives you one pair of X state for D greater than DC, that is the inverted region, and you will find no X state for D less than DC. Now, finally, we have came to the idea that I explained at the beginning. The X state gives the direct way to experimentally distinguish the quantum insulator from the trivial insulator, that is to distinguish between orange and dot. Yeah, so if we can experimentally find this one, then we are done. We can easily say that we have discovered the topological insulator, true topological insulator. So experimental discovery, as I told in the previous slides, the quantum Hall state, the first one, is experimentally observed in the same theoretical prediction, that is the mercury telluride. The quantum well structure was actually fabricated by sandwiching HTT and cadmium telluride. And this is how the experimental setup, the 6-terminal hard bar, looks like. They have 6 terminal with a length here and the width this one. But the thickness is actually overlapping, that means you can vary the thickness there. Anyway, for D less than DC, here you can see the Hall, one more thing. So the exercise is the Hall conductance and the gate, we vary the gate voltage also. So you can see the Hall conductance is 0 for D less than DC, normal reaching. And for D greater than DC, we have the quantized Hall conductance. It is around 2, that means 2 V square by H. So this is the thickness that they use. For D less than 6.3 nanometer, it showed an insulating behavior, and for D greater than 6.3 nanometer, it showed a conducting behavior. That means it became a topological insulator. and this is the actual experimental result looks like. You can see here, this also remember that this is in the zero magnetic field, we are not applying any external magnetic field, and this one is for the Hall resistance and the voltage applied, gate voltage here. So you can see here, for a normal conventional insulator, you can see a maximum resistance. It's almost more than 10 raised to 7 ohm. For this 2, 3 and 4, almost this is insulating. The resistance is coming below 100 kilo ohm. And especially for 3 and 4, that is the inverter region, you can see the hard the resistance has decreased drastically. So this is the thing. And two important facts are, this residual conductance is actually independent of the width of the sample, the width I showed you before. And if you apply an external magnetic field, then this is destroyed. That means the topological insulating phase is destroyed. So the green and the red one is actually for different width. It's for 7.3 nanometer. You can see here, which is one micrometer and one micrometer and 0.5 micrometer. And anyway, this is the result that they got. Now we are heading towards the 3D topological insulator. So in 2006. The theoretically prediction, the Kane and Millay actually theoretically predicted the existence of the possibility of the existence of a 3D topological insulator. And you know, in the previous 2D topological insulator, we had an insulating surface state and we had a conducting edge state, and here we have a insulating butt state and conducting surface state. That's the thing. So here the surface state actually crosses the Fermi level, which you can see later. And here, for this theoretical understanding, the simplest Hamiltonian that can describe this 3D topological insulator phase is actually given by this one, where we consider the spin and momentum locking as done before. So the Hamiltonian along the xy plane, the momentum along px and py is equal to minus I cos vf in z direction plus sigma dot p, where sigma is the spin and p is the momentum. And this is how the surface state, just a cartoon of the surface state. And also the surface below its zone has for time reversal invariant point like this. This is the surface band structure, almost looks like this, and the point at the center, the black point here, is actually the constant energy contour that's in the first of the Fermi level, which maybe you can understand in the further slides. So the surface state energy EP can be obtained by solving the eigenvalue equation similar to the Hamiltonian told you before. And this is actually B sigma P psi is equal to energy state energy, surface state energy into psi, where psi is described by the wave function in the spin-off. And you can see this gives a solution as this one, and this describes a conical structure with this plus and minus energy branches being the conduction and valence branches. And what are the consequences? The consequence that the energy and the momentum of the charge carrier follow a gapless linear dispersion. That's used property shown by a Dirac electron or the Dirac fermion, right? Linear dispersion. And the spin here, you can see the spin and momentum are perpendicular. The spin momentum locking is there. Again, here making them more robust. Now we can experimentally discover the this one. So here you can see bismuth antimony alloy is used, and this is the band structure for pure bismuth. Here the valence band stays above the conduction band here. And you can see there we were reducing the thickness or the width, but here we are reducing, we are changing the concentration of SP. So for a concentration of SP 4%, you can see the band closing happens here. That means the master's 3D direct point is realized at this point. But when you increase the concentration, when it goes greater than 9% or greater than 7%, this is moving down and now this is becoming an insulator. And if you increase it further, then it becomes the usual semi-metal behavior. It shows the semi-metal behavior. And how you can probe it experimentally? The probing is done using APS method. APS method, the simple one, right? You all know the electron in, sorry, the photon in and electron out. So you can measure the change in the kinetic energy and the momentum, and you can get the details about this. And this thing is related to the angle and the potential. Anyway, we can clearly isolate the bulk state from the surface state using APS method, and a much detailed experimental method is spin result one, where you can actually get the spin distribution on the surface, the Fermi surface, using this method. So this is the ARPS intensity map, and here what they did is they actually, the intensity map of the K space, they actually cut through the L points here of the bulk 3D Blowin zone. This is actually the third Blowin zone. Anyway, this is to cut along the KY direction. This is along the KY direction tilted by a 10 degree angle, and this is along the KX direction. Anyway, you can see that this inverted band shape is lying below the Fermi surface. This SS denotes the surface state. So it's lying below the Fermi surface. That means this has a small band gap somewhere here. That means this is the bulk gap. So this material is actually showing the bulk gap. So these are just the momentum distribution curves, and this is how the 3D Blowin zone of this with antimony alloy looks like. This 2D Blowin zone, and this is the projection for the 2D case. Now, how did we measure this? That was the bulk state, and now for the surface state, you can see here the dispersion image is along the gamma point and the M dash point, that is the 2D projected one. So you can see that here the circled one corresponds to the Fermi energy crossing. Energy crossing is happening. That means the surface states have been created. And this 4 and 5 are together, that shows that the two spins are there, spin up and spin down, that thing is there. So this is a zoomed image of the energy crossing, which proves that there is a surface state. And the conclusion that I can give you is that this antimony is direct band gap insulator inside the inverted band gap region, and it is topological material, the conducting surface, it has a conducting surface. Now we have a second generation material. The second generation material is much more advanced. The surface state of the previous one was quite complicated. So they studied some other materials, and bismuth selenate became one of it. And the specialty is that this is a room temperature topological insulator. So you can see they are increasing the temperature from 10 Kelvin to 300 Kelvin, but still the single Dirac cone stays the same. That is robust, it is not at all changing. And this is how the spin momentum looking here. You can see just the Kaira left-handed spin texture here. And also important thing is that in the presence of non-magnetic impurity, as I explained before, in the 2D topological insulator, it is robust, right? Similarly here, it is robust for non-magnetic impurities. You can see the band crossing here. But in the presence of magnetic impurities like iron, something like that, you can see the band gap formation. That means it is coming back to the insulating state. We don't want that to happen. So better not to have a magnetic impurities inside. And this one is the energy density surface electronic state or density diagram. You can see the blue one corresponds to the band bulk state, and this red one corresponds to the head state. So that's the basic area. So what are the applications? This has quite a good application. As I told, this is one of the hot topics. The applications are the topological superconductors, quantum computation, the Majorana formula. It is also applicable in spintronic devices, magnetic devices, and also for making transistors. So when you combine, I'll just go through the topological superconductor because that is a really hot topic now. So we combine the ordinary superconductor, here this case and neodymium selenide, and that is combined with the topological insulator Pa2Sc3. So instead of the Cooper pair formation will be there, but here inside the surface, in the gap between them, the interface, actually the Majorana fermions could be made possible. Majorana fermions is actually a particle which was predicted by the high energy physics people, and then now it is proven to be theoretically proved to be possibly found out, could be found out in the condensed matter here, condensed matter physics there in this topological superconductors. So anyway, Majorana fermions are particles which are its own antiparticles. So if we could detect, if we can create Majorana fermions in this state here, then that can be used as a qubit for quantum computation, right? And this is proved that the topological superconductors has a helical Cooper pairing. That means instead of the spin rotating here, the something similar to the Cooper pair happens here. Two spins are like paired and moves together. So this gives us some hope for finding the Majorana fermions and thereby doing the quantum computation with this thing. So that's it. These are the references of my talk. I use these books and these papers. These are very nice and can give the whole idea about this topological insulator. So you can read through it if you are interested. And yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. If you have any question, you are welcome. I'm happy to have questions from you.